Hello dear students, I am Professor Shraddha Firke from the Computer Science Department of KK Wag Arts Commerce Science and Computer Science College, Kakasaibnagar, Dandi. Today we are going to study the media access sublayer from our computer networking. So what is a multiple access protocols from the media access sublayer? There are three different types of protocols in the multiple access protocols. First one is random access protocols, then the control access protocols, and last one is channelization protocol. So the random access protocol consists of Aloha, CSMA CD, and CSMA CA, while the control access protocols have the reservations, pulling, and token passing. And the channelization protocols are FDMA, TDMA, and the CDMA protocols. Now the first we will study random access protocols. So in this, all the stations will have the same supervisory. That is, no station has some priority than the other stations. Okay. So any station can transmit the data depending on the media's state, that is ideal or busy. And it will have the two features, that there is no fixed time for sending the data, that is you can have the random access to these medium, and there is no fixed sequence of the stations, that is for sending the data. So the first protocol from the random access protocols is Aloha protocol. It was designed for the wireless LANs, but it also applicable for the shared medium also. In this, the multiple stations can transmit the data at the same time and can hence it leads to the collision and data being gathered. So the Aloha method is also divided into two different types, that is pure Aloha and the slotted Aloha techniques. So in pure Aloha, when the station sends the data, it will wait for an acknowledgement. If the acknowledgement do not comes within allotted time, then the station will wait for random amount of time, that is known as a backoff time, backoff strategy. And it will retransmit its data. Since the different stations wait for different amount of time, the probability of the further collision decreases. So the vulnerable time for the pure Aloha is 2 into frame transmission time. The throughput for the pure Aloha is capital G exponential to the raise to minus 2 into g of x, and the maximum throughput value will be 0.184 for the g is equal to 0.5. So this is what the pure Aloha method. Now we will have the slotted Aloha method or the technique. It is similar to the pure Aloha, but it is except that we will divide the times into different slots and send the data, and data is being allowed only at the beginning of these slots. So if the station misses out the allowed time, then it must wait for the next slot. So this will reduce the amount of collision probability. So the vulnerable time period for the slotted Aloha is, it will be equal to the frame transmission time, and the throughput for the slotted Aloha is capital G exponential of minus G. So the maximum throughput is 0.368 for G is equal to 1. So it is double the pure Aloha. So the slotted Aloha technique will reduce the probability of the collision with the double maximum throughput. The second technique from the random access protocols is the CSMA, that is carrier sense multiple access. So it will ensure the fewer collisions as the station is required to first sense the medium, that is the medium is idle or busy before transmitting the data. So if it is idle, then only you can send the data, otherwise it will wait until the channel becomes idle. So however, there is still the chances of collision in CSMA due to the propagation delay. For example, if any station A wants to send the data, it will first sense the channel. It will find that the channel is idle, so it will start transmission, that is it will start sending the data. And however, by the time the first bit of data is being sent or transmitted, it is delayed due to the propagation delay from the station A. And if at the same time the station B requests to send the data and senses the medium, it will also find that it is idle because of the A and B have the same time period to sense the channel, and it will also send the data. So this will result into the collision of the data from station A and B. So there are three different types of CSMA access methods to access the medium. So the first is one persistent CSMA, that is a node senses the channel and if it is idle, it will send the data. Otherwise, it will continuously keep on checking that the medium for being idle and it will transmit unconditionally, that is with the probability of 1. So as soon as the channel gets idle. So therefore, because of its probability, this method is known as one persistent CSMA technique. Then comes a non-persistent technique. What is a non-persistent? In this, a node senses the channel continuously, and if it is idle, it will send the data, and otherwise it will check the medium after the random amount of time. That is not continuously, and it will transmit the data whenever it finds idle channel. So this is what a non-persistent technique. And the next is P persistent. So what is a P persistent? The node senses the medium. If it is idle, it will send the data with the probability capital P. And if the data is not transmitted, that is P minus 1 probability, when it will wait for some amount of time and it will check the medium again. And now if it is found idle, then it will send with the probability P. This will repeat the continuously until the frame is transmitted. So it uses the Wi-Fi or the packet radio systems. And the last one is O persistent. That is, it is a superiority of the nodes is been decided beforehand and the transmission occurs in that order. So if medium is idle, then the node waits for its own time slot to transmit the data. Therefore, it is called the O transmission or the O persistent CSMA access mode. Then the third method from the random access protocols is CSMA CD, that is the carrier sense multiple access with collision detection. That is, in this method, the stations can transmit their transmission of the data if the collision is detected, and it will terminate its execution if and only if the collision is being detected. That is, this technique is the collision detection technique. The next technique is CSMA CA, that is carrier sense multiple access with the collision avoidance. This process of the collisions detecting involves the sender receiving the acknowledgement signals. If there is just one signal, that is its own signal, then the data is successfully transmitted. But if it has a two signals, that is its own signal and one with which it has been collided, then it means the collision is occurred. And to distinguish between these two cases, the collision might have a lot of impact on the received signal. So however, it is not so in wired network, so the CSMA CA is being used in this case. Now the second type of protocols are being controlled access protocols from the medium access sublayer. In the controlled access, the station can consult one another to find which station has to be right to send. So here we have some control on the transmitting nodes or the stations. A station cannot transmit unless it has been authorized by the other stations. That is, there exists one controlled method or the controlled access to access the common channel. So we will discuss the three techniques of the controlled access: reservation, pooling, and the token. So what is mean a reservation? In the reservation method, a station need to make a reservation before transmitting its data. So the time is been divided into the different intervals. So for each interval, a reservation frame has been preceded. The data frame is sent in the interval. So this is how the reservation access method works. For transmitting the signals or transmitting the data, we first have to reserve our position, and this is the direction of the packet movement. So if there are 5 different positions in the reservation frame and the data packet sending the data are 5 different, then if the data station first wants to transmit its packets, then it should reserve first in the reservation system or the reservation frame. And if there exist n number of stations, then there are n number of reservation mini slots, and each mini slots belongs to each station. So the figure shows that here in this situation with the 5 stations, the 5 mini slots is been there for the reservation frame. In the first interval, only the station 1, 3 and 4 have made the reservations, and in the second interval only the first has been made the reservation. So here in first, the station 1, 3 and 4 have been reserved for the reservation frame. They have transmitted their data, and afterwards only the station first have been reserved for transmitting the data. The next method from the controlled access is the pooling method. So what is a pooling? In the pooling, it will work with the topologies in which the one device is designed as a primary station and another device are worked as a secondary. So there exists a master-slave type of communication in the pooling method. So all the data exchange must be made through a primary device, even when the ultimate destination is the secondary device. So the primary device will control the link, and the secondary devices will follow its instructions. So it is up to the primary device to determine which device is allowed to use and the channel at the given time. So there exist 2 different types of functions in pooling access method: select method and pull function. So the primary device is always the initiator in the session, and hence if the primary station falls, the whole system will go down. First one, we will have the select method. In the select function, it is used whenever the primary device has something to send. So that time select operation will be called. Select function: before sending the data, the primary station will create and create and transmits a select frame, that is SEL frame, one field of which include the address of the intended secondary, and to alert the secondary to have the upcoming transmission, and it will wait for an acknowledgement. So after receiving an acknowledgement, when the primary is ready to receive the data, it will transmit an acknowledgement. So in the pull function, whenever the primary station is ready to receive the data, it will first ask for the pull. So each and every device in the turn, if it has anything to transmit. If the secondary device responds with the negative acknowledgement, that is an acknowledgement frame, so it means that there is nothing to send. But when the primary station pulls the next secondary until it finds the one, that is the data to be sent. So when the response is in the positive, that is a data frame has been transmitted, the primary will read the frame and it will return an acknowledgement frame verifying that it is received. Now the third type of controlled access protocols is the token passing method. In the token passing method, the stations in the network are being organized in the logical ring. In other words, each station, there is a predecessor and the successor. The predecessor is the station which is logically before the station in the ring, and the successor station which is after the station in the ring. The current station is the one that is accessing the channel now, and the write has been passed from the predecessor to the current station and will be passed to the successor when the current station has no more data to send. So there exists a passing of the token in between predecessor and the current station and the successor in the ring. So how the logical ring and the physical topologies in the token passing method follows a special packet called as a token that has been circulated through the ring, and the position of the token gives the station the right to access the channel and transmit the data. So there exist a four different types of token passing methods. In first, it is a physical ring topology. Here, a station will send the token to its successor, that is the next one in this line. So from 1, it will go to 2, it will go to 4, it will go to 3, this way. So the token do not have to have the address of the next successor. If one of the link fails, the whole system will fail in the physical link. Now the next is dual ring. Dual ring consists of, it uses the second ring for emergency only. When it operates in the reverse direction, the original ring has the forward direction and the secondary will have the reverse direction. So if one link is in the main ring fails, the system automatically combines the two rings to form a temporary ring. So each station need to have two transmitter ports and two receiver ports in the dual ring method. The third one is bus ring topology. So the stations are connected to a single cable called as a bus, and they make a logical ring because each station knows the address of its successor. So when a station has finished the sending its data, it will release a token that has been the address of next successor, and only the station with that address gets the token. And the last one is star ring. In the star ring, the physical topology is a star topology. So there is a hub in between that will act as a connector, and the stations that are connected to the ring that will go through the two wire connection. So the network is less prone to the failure because of the link goes down and it will be bypassed by the hub. So adding and removing the stations from this link is also easier. The third type of protocols from the MAC sublayer are the channelization. The channelization, that is channel partition, as it is sometimes called, a multiple access methods in which the available bandwidth of a link is shared in time, frequency, or through the codes among the different stations. So there exist three different protocols like FDMA, TDMA, and CDMA. First, we will see the frequency division multiple access. In the FDMA, the available bandwidth is been divided into the frequency band. So each station is allocated a band of frequency to send its data. In other words, each band is received for a specific station and it belongs to the station all the time. So each station will also have or use a bypass filters, that is the transmitting only a set of range of frequencies to confine the transmission or the transmitter frequencies to prevent the station from the interference. The allocated bands are being separated each from each another by the small guard bands. So this is how the frequency division multiple access method works. Here is one station and the whole frequency band is divided into different smaller frequency bands. And each station will have the different frequency band. For example, this is the common channel and the whole channel is divided into four different frequency bands. First frequency band is being allocated to the station 1, second will be allocated to the station 3, third will be allocated to station 2, and the fourth will be allocated to station 4. So the available bandwidth of the common channel is divided into the bands that has been separated by the guard bands, and the data link layer in each station will tell its physical layer to make the bandpass signals from the data passed to it. The next method is time division multiple access. So the in TDMA, the stations will share the whole bandwidth of a channel but in time. So the each station is allocated a time slot during which it can transmit its data and it can use the whole bandwidth of a channel. Each station can transmit its data in its assigned time slot. So this is how the TDMA works. There exist four channels, then the whole channel is been divided for into different time slot and each time slot is been allocated to different station. So the bandwidth is just one channel, that is time shared between the different stations, and the data link layer in each station tell its physical layer to use the allocated time slot. Now the last one is CDMA, that is code division multiple access. It was several decades ago. But in recent advanced in electronic technologies have finally made it implement possible. In the CDMA, it is differed from the FDMA in that only one channel occupies the entire bandwidth of a link. In CDMA, it is differed from TDMA in that all the stations can send the data simultaneously. But there is no time sharing because there is a code division multiple access. So how it is been done? The simple idea of communicating with the codes that each station is assigned some code, and if a station wants to transmit the data, it will multiply its data with its code, and the data that goes on the channel are the sum of those multiplication terms. So to get this data, the receiver multiplies the data on the channel by the code of the sender. For example, suppose if there exists a station 2 that is wants to send the data to station 1. So it will multiply its own data on the channel by C1. That is the code for station 1. So its data packets are D1, D2, D3 and D4. And it will multiply its data with C1, C2, C3, C4. That are the codes for station 1. So because of C1, C1, it is 4. Because of C1, C1 and C1, C3, C2, C1, C3, C1 and C4, C1. Or all zeros, so the station 2 will divide the result by 4 and to get the data from the station 1. So I hope we have studied today the different multiple access sublayer or the media access sublayer protocols that consist of the random access protocol, the channelization protocol, and the controlled access protocol. So thank you so much.